Hello, hello! Welcome back to my unschooling talks. It's number 18. Hello, hello. I'm waiting for someone being live here and for my guest today. And you see, I'm here she is. Hold on a second. It's my unschooling talk number 18. And here you are. Hey, welcome,
hello,
Sasha.
Hello.
I'm so excited to have you here today, tonight in my area. I'm not sure what time of the day it's at your place.
Morning. It's almost 10 a.m. here.
Okay. So it's the 18th edition of the Unschooling Talk, and some of them are German, some of them are English. And my intention for doing those talks is to raise awareness of how is it possible to raise kids without school? There is so many options without school, unschooling, homeschooling, and everything in between. And that's the reason why I'm choosing those wonderful moms, mostly, sometimes dad, mostly moms, to have a talk with me on that area and on that topic. And today, Sascha Schlossberg, it's actually a German name, right?
Yes. You pronounce it beautifully.
You live in Arizona. You have four kids. Would you like to introduce the rest of you for yourself, please?
Sure. Yeah. It's funny. I don't know and I'll admit I was a little nervous for the idea of this chat, because it's like I talk about business and marketing, but I don't usually talk about all of the old things came up, the idea of like, am I qualified? But yes, I've been doing this for 3 years now. And how I think that it's so interesting. I think all of us come to homeschooling in different ways. Like, do any of us necessarily plan on it in advance? I don't think so. It wasn't the plan for us at all. And I have so many questions for you though, about how it is in Austria and in Europe to undergo this. Like, we're in Arizona where it's pretty flexible, especially compared to California where we're from. Here it's like it's a kindergarten optional state. In some states in the US, kindergarten's required. So it's kindergarten optional. So you don't even have to register with the state until they're six. So in, 2 months, I'll register my second kid. And from there, it's really very, very, very lax, I would say, compared to other states where some you have to show up and you have to do testing there's requirements. Here it's not so specific, which is nice.
So how can I imagine it? You register your kid and you say it's not going to school, and then is there any other thing of, I mean, is there people coming from somewhere, or is there any tests, or is there any assignment or curriculum, or have you to be in contact with
I would say this is a state where more people are, because there's greater flexibility. Like, there's some community pieces, like there's co-ops but there isn't that sense of pressure, because you don't have to teach for any of the exams or any of that kind of thing. And especially for minors so little, it's not really a concern at this point. I believe when they get bigger, I believe you can optionally do state exams, some of those yearly exams. I know for us, it's like the reason why we started, I was just going to homeschool preschool for my oldest. But when I started the preschool curriculum, she could already read. And I was like, oh, okay, so I guess she's too advanced for this. So I started her on a kindergarten curriculum when she was, should have started preschool four or five, like older preschool. So I started her on this pretty rigorous curriculum, and she just flew through. I was like, oh, well, then the next year is like, well, she's too advanced. So I don't want to put her in school because she's academically advanced, but emotionally still, young. So that wasn't going to be the right thing. So then that was the homeschooling the second year. But the second year, I picked a curriculum. Like the first one was this very traditional, rigorous, all of the subjects every day sort of thing, sit at your desk, lots of papers. Then the next year, I picked one that was more what you would call unit based. So learning about the continent of Asia. And so every day you're coloring the picture, but you're learning about the food. And it was a more interactive style. But still, there's so little. I mean, if you imagine me doing this the second year, my older two are like 6 and 4. It's still so small for even that level of structure. So this year, our third year, I think, doing it, I was like, we'll go back to the more structured curriculum. And part of this is the flexibility piece. This year, we're like, we'll go back to structured since we have. They're getting a little bigger, meaning 7 and 5, and then there's the 3 and the 1 year old. And I even got a preschool curriculum for the younger two, which is literally just children's books and singing songs and waving your hands in the air and doing all those little activities, right? But I found that after like 2 weeks, they didn't want to do it. And it's not that they don't like learning, they love learning. But sitting there when the work is too easy every day is like, now what? So instead, now we've shifted more towards what you would call, I guess, traditional unschooling. I don't even know. That's part of, I'm like, I don't even know the rules. What are the rules of unschooling versus homeschooling? So instead, I'm looking at, the math book for my little guy and going, okay. Well, what looks like it's going to be fun for him today? And for him, that's coloring all the pictures, going through page after page of, he did like probably 4 weeks worth of assignments for math because it was interesting to him. And then we're not going to touch the math today. So instead of feeling the pressure to follow the curriculums, what's working for us is going, what is it that they need to learn? What should they have accomplished? How can we make it fun for them? And then what are the things that they're not learning so much in school that we would want them to learn? So for us, we want them to learn about other cultures. And most of the dates and facts and figures we'll get into when they're older. For me, it's more important that they're having fun learning how to learn, so that should we put them in school that I was a military brat, so I moved a lot. So I know that every time you switch schools, there's an adjustment, right? So for me, it's like, how can I just make them have fun and be confident so that those are the most important things that then you can take those into any life experience? Because ultimately, school is another life experience. So I think extracting the mandatory learning from it, knowing we can cover that, and then the life experience and the social piece, like addressing that as a separate piece.
How many in percentage, how many people are having their kids not in school in Arizona? Do you know
I
a
don't
number?
know. I don't know. I know that homeschooling is common enough here that in some places, if your kids are out of school during the day, people would ask, oh, no school today. Whereas people don't usually, I think one person has ever said that to us. So homeschooling is common enough that we don't get weird looks for being out during the day. Do you encounter that? Do you encounter
Yes, and there is not even I mean, usually there is not even a thought that it could be different than school. I mean,
Wow. Yeah,
in
it's very,
Austria
it's
it
not.
is like before the pandemic it was, how much was it? Like 2% of the school aged kids were not in school, which is, I mean, 2% is really not much.
Tiny.
Now it's maybe 5,
Okay.
but probably not anymore either. During
Oh.
that, a lot of kids went back to school after those past 2 years. So
Okay.
maybe 3, 4, 5, 4%. Yeah.
I
So that's
mean,
not a lot.
no,
Yeah.
I'm very curious about the percentage. And it's funny to me, though, as an adult, it would never occur to me if I saw a child out to be like, oh, you do not have school today. Like, it wouldn't occur to me, but I guess it is. There's still, and it's only ever older people that say that. So I think that is some of the generational stuff where it's just like, well, automatically, automatically
Yeah.
you see a child and you assume they must be in school. I think some of that's generational. Let me
We are
see.
still in this generation over here.
Over there.
Yes. So this sounds like a lot of freedom, isn't it? I mean, how
Yeah.
you describe how you do and work and learn and play with your kids, and it sounds there is a lot of freedom, not only for you but also for the kids, right? I mean, if
Yeah,
they
very
do they
much
have to
so.
do you approach it that they have to do something every day or
Yes, actually, not, yes.
I'm sorry.
Oh, bless you. Yes, but it
Thank you.
is funny because it's things like we'll say we'll say to them, if you were in school, you would have to sit at a desk all day and you would have to do things. So if you'd like to for it to still be fun and you not have to sit at the desk every day, then don't give me a hard time when you do have to sit. So it's those sorts of talks because some days it is, they're on the, now that they're getting a little bigger, they're on the iPads and they're doing a coding app or that sort of thing. But yes, I mean, because we don't sit every day at the desk, then the days they do, then there is some resistance to it. But we do. So I have a friend who used to come over and she would do our food prep for us. Our kids are in the same Taekwondo. And so we were talking about the school year started here and all of that. And I was saying that we had done the curriculum very rigorously and then fallen off. And she pointed out, she's like, because she's been in our house with us, she's like, but Sasha, she's like, you all are constantly doing learning activities. You build learning in as a lifestyle. So remember that even if they're not sitting down and following, I was like, oh, thank you for that. Like somebody else who's been in here and seen it, because it is easy to forget. If my kids aren't sitting down to do schoolwork, it's still, I'm very much, I encourage boredom time. So when they come and say, I'm bored, I'm like, good, good. Be bored. Create something from that. And arts and crafts, and honestly, seeing what they create from boredom time is something that I try to create space for them every day. And then, I mean, I was looking at pictures that I just developed. We like going to, they do these immersive art experiences. So before we go to those, we'll look online and I'll show them pictures of the artist and we'll talk about that kind of art and then we'll go to that. So, or we were just traveling. We went to LA last week. We just got back on Sunday and talking about stories about what this building means or the history of what's happened here, different cultures, all that kind of, we build all of those in. So I say that we do, maybe obnoxiously so, build in learning moments all the time versus just okay, school and then you're done. Ever I think I've taken that responsibility seriously to show that learning can come from all kinds of things versus just what's in the textbooks. Because I remember, I think it wasn't until maybe college or something when you start to go, I was like in an amazing history class. And I realized that the history tied into something I learned in another class. And I was like, oh, it's all connected. But I didn't realize that till college. So I think showing that it's all connected earlier on also makes the teaching easier. We do a lot of, not a lot of, but we do some subscription box services. So there's one called KiwiCo that delivers their steam boxes each month. So from the tiny age, they're learning about putting things together, reading directions, physics, trial and error, all of those things, so that then how to use a ruler. So then when you get to math, they go, oh, or when you're spending money is math. So then when you get to math time, it's like, oh, remember when you did this? So tying what they're learning into real life makes the learning process easier as well. But then it makes it funny when we consider, like, well, we put them in school. And then what kind of school would work, and what neighborhood do you move to if you're going to try to find the right school? So many, I feel like there's just as many variables in choosing a school as there are in deciding to homeschool. It's all, there's so many decisions. Is it like that in Austria? Are there different school philosophies and different kinds of schools too?
Yes, it's not a huge variety, but there are some alternative schools, and yeah, but it depends also where you live and how you know how much you have to choose, you have the choice from. There were so many things you already talked about. I want to know more about. Once those boxes you mentioned, this is something I really love, because this is something I think places where homeschooling and is much more tradition than around here, you have more I'm having a hard time with some vocabularies today, with some structured content for homeschooling. Here, there is basically none. I mean, everything that you want, you have to, or it gets built now. I mean, it's becoming more and more slowly a thing. So it's becoming more and more things on the market, but basically there isn't anything or not much. So I always, when I talk to moms from the US and they tell me about all those ready made curriculum stuff, I think this is amazing.
And it wasn't always like that here, because I homeschooled in 7th and 8th grade, and at that point there were only two sets. So I was an actor, but we lived 2 hours away from LA, so we're still actors, but at the time I was a kid actor. So 2 hours from LA, in order to miss school, you can't miss that much school. So, and the schools weren't very good, so we homeschooled. So, but at the time, the only people that really homeschooled were like the trouble kids, the pregnant teens, and the religious zealots, fundamentalists. So those were the only groups. So we looked at like a co-op, but it was just some fundamentalists, and that wasn't the vibe. And so we went through this alternative school program. And it was so funny because it was separated by a fence from like the problem children. Very strange sort of thing. But I would go in, I don't know, once a week, once every 2 weeks, with my stack of essentially showing that I was doing all the work. And but all my work was, so at the time in California, if you homeschooled, and I don't know what the laws are now, but if you homeschooled, you had to spend 4 hours a day on your schoolwork. That was pretty much it, to my recollection. And then you had all of your textbooks. So you had your math, English, just all of your subject matter books. You use the same ones that they used at the school, just at home. And that was really it. So I remember, like, I really enjoyed reading. So I did my entire year's literature in 7th or 8th grade within like a month or two, which just meant I didn't have anything else to do in that subject for the entire school year. Like, that was just, you have these things, and if they're done, then they're done. Whereas now, some people do school that way. Like, a lot of the online programs or virtual programs are that same sort of thing. You're just doing your academic work, subject matter work, and then you're done. But we intentionally don't do it that way. Because I think it is, otherwise, as an entrepreneur, when you grow up, you spend so much time unlearning that I think it's, for us, it's far more important that they learn specific qualities and they learn how to learn. That's more powerful than, okay, and now you're going to memorize this and that. Though I do, like, in Arizona, I guess they don't push memorization of math facts. So you have high schoolers that are counting on their fingers. I was like, that's not acceptable for me. So like, some of my own standards are higher than that of the schools. I'm like, no, we're going to memorize math facts. Like, my second grader did second grade math last year, but she doesn't have her facts memorized. So I'm not going to have her do third grade math this year. Instead, we're just going to spend the year really integrating, and really getting the math memorization, getting a strong foundation. But yeah, there are so many ready-made curriculums, whether it's faith-based or not, or you can create your own. You can do unit-based learning, or this one that I've done a couple times, Memoria Press, which is, I mean, they start Latin in second grade, so we're doing some Latin. There are so many, there's so many options, but then there's so many subscription kits that you can get. We have one called talkbox.mom, which is languages. You get language boxes. So we're working on French, horrendously slowly, but we're working on French as a family, to give the kids, you know, additional language skills. There's so many resources available now. It's far less daunting than it used to be, at least in the US.
So what was the reason in the end? Why did you choose the path without school so far, at least?
For now, it's that I don't really like the school options where we are. We're very, very far north in a suburban area. So there's lots of schools, but they're not diverse. And as a minority, I'm sensitive to that. I don't enjoy mm-hmm. being the only person of color in a room. And the closest schools are 85% white. So I do believe that being a minority in a space puts you at a disadvantage socially. So mm-hmm. I would rather not do that to my kids. So, and there is actually one school that's pretty rigorous that is diverse, but it's like, for now, it feels right to still keep them home. And maybe it'll change next year. It's like, we just take each year as it comes, mm-hmm. and doing what's best in the moment, and then, but also not trying to make it so that we can be flexible. If we put them in school, that they wouldn't be behind, for example.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned, as an entrepreneur, we have to unlearn so many things. I think, if you're in the personal development field, we have to unlearn a lot anyway. And what is, as an, do you have certain areas and topics you observe on yourself walking that path of homeschooling with your kids that have you specifically unlearn something?
I'll say that what I see, like, for example, in my oldest, is that, because schoolwork is always very easy for me as well, but the idea that just because you do well in school, you'll get a good job or make a lot of money, that's completely absurd. There's no correlation between those. So for me, it's less about my kids being, quote, smart or getting good grades. Like, that's just a given. That's just a given for them. For me, it's far more important that they learn specific qualities, like that they learn hard work, or that being uncomfortable won't hurt them, that they're safe to be uncomfortable. Those things mm-hmm. are far more important for them to learn, because otherwise it is a shock if you are good at school and then you get out and you're like, oh, but this is what's happening. This is hard. I think that kids that, for example, school is harder, end up luckier in many ways, because they've learned that they're safe to be uncomfortable and they can work hard and all of those things. So those are the things that I'm conscious of for my little ones, is what are the qualities I want them to learn if the things that school pretends are important aren't really important.
And have you discovered for yourself some of those things that you maybe still believe that some skills are important, you learn at school, and now as a homeschooling mom, you discover that it isn't? Is there any?
I think mine are still too little for that. You know, I've seen people that say, oh, algebra, it doesn't matter. But so I don't know if they still do it, but United Airlines used to do, when you'd fly to Hawaii from LAX, this contest that whoever could guess the exact time that you pass the geographical midpoint wins a bottle of wine. I won that twice as a minor using algebra. So for me, like, I'm like, yes, I think using these things, and I'll admit I had extra entries because I took my whole family's entries. I would do it and then use all their entries too. But I mean, like, I do believe that the math and the sciences and all of those things are very important. I just don't believe that we need to sit there for 8 hours a day to do it. I think that the education piece is important. But I think that education is a part of life is important, whereas with school, there's a lot of language around school year. When it's done, it's done. When you graduate and then graduate, and then when you graduate college, it's done. Whereas the thing that's been most effective for me is constantly learning and investing in my own learning. So I think that what I've developed is a very different perspective of education. And so that learn modeling that and showing my kids that, I think, is probably overrides what I do or don't agree with within. And also showing the kids that, teachers are just people too. Everybody's just people. So teaching the kids that people are just people from the time they're little. And yes, everybody deserves respect. The kids deserve respect too. Like, some of those things are different to what you would learn in school.
And in the social aspect, I mean, these are all those academic ones, socially. Do you have any standards that wouldn't have been met in school, or the other way around? Do you feel you're lacking something because they are not in school? How is your approach on that?
It's interesting because I think my kids are all what people call neurodiverse. So mine are already not, I call them my little weirdos. And it's not that they're it's like my oldest is just really, really advanced as far as smart, right? And my second guy has an insane amount of energy. So for me, I think that eventually they'd be like my second grader. I think she would be completely fine if I put her in a school setting now. I don't think she would have been necessarily 2 years ago. I think it would have overwhelmed her emotionally. And same thing for my little guy. I think it might have been maybe too much, depending on the setting. But now I think, so I also take all of it with a grain of salt. It's like, just because maybe something doesn't, I think that there's always something that can use attention. So, like, for the social piece, I think they would be fine now if I put them in school. We've emphasized, like, how can we teach them adaptability and resilience, for example. But we do have them in extracurriculars. So my oldest has been in Taekwondo with the same kids for 3 years. And she goes to a group piano lesson. So they do experience some of the social dynamics, just not on the day in, day out scale of being with kids that are exactly their same age. I think mine, instead, are learning more to interact with kids of a variety of age ranges. Because that's how Taekwondo is, for example, and piano. I am curious about the one thing I don't know is what is the necessity or benefit of putting kids in with, 20 to 30, their exact same age. I don't know if there's a benefit to that long term, because it doesn't really mirror anything beyond that academic, that your 12 to 16 years of academics. So I don't know. I don't know. I mean, they go out, and I'd say mine are probably more comfortable talking to people of all ages than kids that are only in school with kids of their own age. Mine are just as likely to start asking adults questions as kids their own age. And I don't think that that's necessarily common. But I don't know, because I just have my own kids.
And yeah, this is something I'm not sure if you have observed already, if you can see differences observing kids from who are schooled and kids who are homeschooled or unschooled in their behavior throughout society? Have you any experiences of that? Can
I
you?
think my kids are generally kinder. I mean, because that's something that's important to us is kindness. So when other kids aren't kind, they're kind of thrown for a loop. So sort of explaining those sorts of things is interesting. Yeah, in some, I mean, yeah, I would say that's interesting. Mine are definitely kinder, and I would say more communicative with people of all ages than kids that are just in a traditional school environment, for sure. Yeah.
I mean, what or at least my understanding, what I observe from kids in school and what you just talked about, the same all kids 20, 30 kids in the same age. What happens there, in my observation, is that the competition starts a lot because you can compare them easier. Now they are all the same age, they have the same curriculum, and when they start comparing each other more, I think, than if an 8-year-old and a 12-year-old and a 19-year-old and whatever. It's not that obvious that there is to compare each other
That's
or
interesting.
themselves. And this is also then where I think those social dilemmas like bullying and stuff starts. And in those other groups. Especially if there is an emphasis on like you said, caring or some other social, emotional, educational things, there is very, very, I easily see a different behavior most of the time, among kids there in school versus kids there not in school.
Yeah, I mean, my little guy was bullied one time at the gym. We have this gym membership that has a, it's called Lifetime. So it's, they call them, I don't know what they call them, lifestyle gyms or something, but they have a whole kids academy. So they have a lot of kids programming, activities, et cetera. And some older kid was bullying my little guy one day. I can't remember why, but so we did. We talked about that. I think that's part of why I think some people would view school as a good thing because they learn to navigate all these things. I'm like, well, they're going to learn to navigate them as long as they're in the real world at all. Like, we were traveling and our Airbnb was not in a good neighborhood. And my little guy said, he's 5, he's almost 6. He's like, I stuck my tongue out at 2 cars and the second one put their middle finger up at me. I was like, ugh. I was like, well, you're not supposed to stick your tongue out at people. And like, so it's like if you're existing out in real life, like when our kids aren't, yes, they're homeschooled, but they're not sheltered. We take them out to like the art experience we went to, they feature nudity. So it says it's recommended ages 13 and up. I'm like, N a naked body's not going to kill any of my, they'll be fine. They can see that, right? Nudity and art, or even art that's dark, like it's fine. So they're homeschooled, but they're not sheltered. So they're still going to see and experience, and we're going to navigate the same things. Just you don't have to be in a school environment to be bullied or to have somebody flip you off, you know? That's, yeah. I think we navigate these things just by nature of being humans if we choose to live in a, I guess, a diverse world. Because you could put your kid in school and not take them anywhere, and they're getting whatever these social experiences are, but then they're not getting the world experiences.
Do you travel? Do you, I mean, you suggested to title our talk "Flexibility is the most important value." I'd like to dig into that a little bit more as well. Do you relate this also to traveling and the time freedom as a family? And how are those values for you? You can go whenever you want to whatever place you want. You can your kids can sleep or get up in the morning whenever they want. Is it the case? Is it something you
Yeah, I
value
mean,
as a
I would say that's the goal of it. My small humans wake up between like 5:30 and 6, so so they're the alarm clock.
Okay,
Technically,
they're
they
still
could
very
sleep
young. Yes,
in.
yes, yes.
Yes, and we do have we do have structures and routines. The afternoon they have. Oh, excuse me. Taekwondo 3 afternoons a week, and then Saturday is one kid has, or Friday, two of them have gymnastics. So we have some of these structures, and then they're encouraged to practice their extracurriculars, outside of that as well. But yeah, I mean, the idea is that we, have flexibility for whatever the other things are. So, like, as actors, we get. We have an audition request for our 1-year-old. So that's something that's going to take time. While I'm doing this video, my husband took all 4 of them to go run an errand, to go run a couple of errands so that it's quiet here. And then when they come back, I'm not sure what the plan will be, but we don't have any calls for the rest of today. I know tomorrow is Wednesday's my day of client calls. So I have back-to-back one-on-one calls. So during that time, he'll do the schooling with the kids, and it's whatever he plans on doing with them for that day. But yeah, the idea that we can, and the way that I've built in all of my client work is that I have all my calls are the first 3 weeks of the month. And then the 4th week, and if it's every quarter, there's a 5th week, that's a bonus week. So people, it gives everybody, because this I work year round, so this gives everybody time off to either implement or rest, or I'll do deep dive one-on-ones with new clients during that week. But that's also the best week to travel, so that we can travel then, and it hasn't uprooted. I'm not in some hotel room doing all of my calls while he's fielding all the kids. So the flexibility in also knowing that what worked 1 year or even what worked 1 month might need to shift for the next month. Like maybe when we started the curriculum and go, oh, this is actually too structured and this isn't working. Looking at it that way is flexibility is an overall value is helpful because it's what's the biggest goal? Yeah, what's the biggest goal versus being? It can be easy to go, okay, well, I bought this curriculum, I must follow this curriculum. But why if it's not working? Because you could easily bring your kids home, homeschool them, and have this terrible curriculum or this experience where you're all just fighting with each other and it's all a struggle, in which case there is no benefit to that. So
Yes.
flexibility in the goal of what they're learning or learning how they're learning, that piece is that's why the flexibility is a value. Plus then it gives you the permission. It's the reminder that you're always giving yourself permission to go, oh, maybe I found an amazing school that they will go into in the future. Because people do, it's easy to feel stuck. So that's why I do recommend that anybody that's homeschooling or wants to homeschool that they are considering giving themselves permission to be flexible.
Yeah. This is a wonderful topic because actually when kids have to be in school, like in Germany, you don't have, even the option of homeschooling. In Austria, a lot very little people amount of people are homeschooling. So when you think of it that kids from the age, I mean starting with kindergarten mo mainly 3-year-old, some even earlier, until at least, I mean you have to be schooled here in Austria until 15, 16 at least. So in this time frame, you as a young human don't really have much power over your time. Like your time is scheduled. And so I feel that you never learn to be flexible with your time. Not only with your time, also with your topics, because you know it's all given, it's all prepared, it's all from the outside, what, when, with whom you
Yeah.
are working with. And or even the word working already, yeah.
Yes.
Do I want to work? What is work for me? And how do I approach people, topics? These are actually, this is a kind of flexibility I like to have for my kid to grow up with those kind of values that he learns himself through interaction with whatever is in his interests and whoever he chooses to be with and whenever and however. So I think there is much more possibility to get to know yourself in this critical time of our lives, you know. I mean, we all
Yeah.
know how we get conditioned to whatever we do in those young years.
And that's interesting too, because thinking about the idea of like, you know, to play devil's advocate, like what's the benefit of school? Well, they are opening loops, closing loops, completing things, but and you can set up those same things. Like I look at it on a little scale when my kids create their Kiwi crate. Okay, this is a full project. They're creating a project, but they have control over when they start it and when they finish it. And if they lose all the pieces, then they lose all the pieces, right? So they're learning that, learning the responsibility of that, but kind of on their own. Or in the case of martial arts, like they go, oh, okay, well, there's a belt test usually each month. If they do the hard work and they show up and they focus, they'll be eligible for their belt test. If not, their friends are going to test and they're not. So learning like cause and effect within and starting and completing projects and the benefits of hard work, those can be done in a number of ways that it's just the difference between whether we're giving the school or the state or the government responsibility for teaching the kids these things, or if we're taking on the responsibility for it.
And there is also this the option, like you already mentioned, schooling easily is seen from a kid's perspective. There is always someone else taking the responsibility. I mean, this can be in homeschooling as well, depend how you do it. And this is in my books anyway, the difference between unschooling and homeschooling. And this is something I love to research from these talks as well, how everyone is approaching these terms. But for me, homeschooling means working through a curriculum, and unschooling means really giving the kid the lead of what it wants to discover, spend its time with, and in what way, and following their own interests, and the adults guide it basically, and are here for if there are questions, and they need to discover something together. But there is no real curriculum in unschooling unless the kids chooses one
That's
itself from
cool.
itself. So, and in that range, I see in that range, I see I see a variety on how the kid itself can experience not really responsibility yet, but self I think actualization is the word in English. I'm doing something, it has an effect, and it falls back to me. And how do I deal with that? And with that, I of course, that's a deep learning, I mean, those experiences really,
Yeah. Embodied.
anchoring, yeah.
Because that's an interesting thing, because I could imagine with my kids, right? Let's say that I said, you know what? We're gonna go full unschooling. We're not even gonna touch math books. Eventually, there's going to be some point when they're going to realize other kids know math and they don't, and they're going to want to learn it, and they're just going to blow through it really quickly. Like there are those things they go, oh, somebody else, well, this person can tie their shoes. Well, this person's potty trained. I want to do that too. So some of those interesting social dynamics, like, and they do when, and that's the big difference too with like why for us we don't do math every day is it either they're going to phone it in or they're going to be engaged and just like hoover it up and then it's easy and it clicks. And so
Exactly.
whatever way you can do that, it's like when we look at, I would imagine Europe was the same way, but before the government took over schooling, people would work with tutors for specific subjects. You would learn a subject over a period of time and then you would work on something different. It wasn't always, 5 days a week from 8 till 3 on. Learning didn't have to be disconnected.
And also the most very important piece to me is the relationship to the tutor or the teacher. And I mean, as an adult, I hardly can imagine to learn something that is re really crucial for me from somebody I can't deal with, I can't stand, I don't like, you know?
Oh my goodness, yes. I'm still the
And
teachers that I had that didn't like me as a child. And I'm like, that is, if you think about it, that's such a strange thing to have a small child know their teacher doesn't like them. Why? It's very weird. It's very weird. But yeah, I can think of a number of them that I knew just did not like me.
since my son is 13, we have had a few different tutors in very different areas, but he was always the one choosing the person he would work with. And this is such a difference, right? I
That's
mean,
cool.
this doesn't mean that there are not issues coming up maybe, but still he wanted, and he then feels like he's in power and in charge to deal with it, versus when someone is just set in front of you and you never had the choice to choose, then the resignation is much easier, and you feel much easier or quicker, probably powerless to deal with whatever issue it is, right?
Yeah, I mean, I could see that even, yeah, their desire to work with somebody, their desire to learn something, it really does make all the difference. It does in any, whether it's sports or it's like with Taekwondo, there was a period of time when my oldest didn't want to do it anymore, to which we replied, well, make it to your ne complete your next belt test and then you can be done if you want. Because that would mean that she was into the upper echelon of belts. Once she passed that, she wanted to do it. It then she became self-motivated again, which is just a very fascinating thing. I know some people would just let their child quit, but that was curious for me to see the difference, or seeing, if they like a coach versus if they don't like a coach, how they behave in sports. It's interesting. There's just always so much to learn.
Yeah, totally. And I guess that like the example you just said with Taekwondo, I guess this is also different for different kids, you know? For some kid it's a good motivation to say, hey, complete this piece of whatever part of education it is, and then you can choose, versus maybe another kid loses, you make something, you destroy something if it has to go further, or even though it already said, I don't want to go any further, you know? So I guess it's a
Yeah.
very individual thing, and this is the kind of flexibility I really appreciate as well.
Yeah.
And it's not this one thing everybody has to deal with, you know?
Right. It's very yeah. And then I guess the knowing of or hoping to know what's best for your child, right? Yeah, because I think about it, it's like she's for my oldest with the Taekwondo example, she's small, she had liked it, and then suddenly she doesn't. So what are all the variables at play? I think is definitely different than, if some kid is much older and wants to quit something at some point, or yeah, what's the difference between perhaps a phase or them learning their own knowing and not and trusting that kind of thing.
With my son, we have experienced that he wanted to quit something, and it was okay for us. And over a period of time, his interest came back, and he started all not all over, but he started again
up.
and started up again. So, and
That's
I for myself know as well. I sometimes want breaks in my rhythm, not necessarily in the rhythm of. I easily can get caught up. Okay, I need to finish this. I need to finish this. But if I really look at me at myself.
Yeah,
I'm really losing energy in finishing things when I'm overriding my need of getting a break, and
Ooh,
I can
do you
finish
look
it.
at? Do you pay attention to your kid's human design?
I only have one son, and he's a projector.
Okay.
So he definitely needs his time out when he needs it. Yeah.
Yeah.
You look into that too. I just
yes.
had the last unschooling talk a couple of days ago. I had with a coach who does human design in her work as well. You might know her. She's from Tennessee.
I don't know. I'll have to go look. I love. I'm not. I know basics of it, but I do. I love to. Note, you know, what is somebody's general design, just to know, because that really does indicate. So that can indicate too. My oldest is a projector with no emotional authority at all. So for her, what's so fascinating is what I find works the best. Whereas my middle two, I think they're both generators. I think I forget. My middle two though are very much like, I want to do this sport. And they'll dive in. My oldest never initiates on any, so we'll select things for her, and then she loves them or she doesn't. So when she was little, she had wanted to do ballet, and it wasn't the right thing. But I think she liked the outfit, so we put her in. It was not the right thing. We didn't have her do it. We had her audition for a play. She loved the entire process. Wants to do another one. Okay, we need a break because that was a huge time commitment. And then we're like, okay, we'll put her in that one. So yeah, and there's definitely days when she's like, and so we only have her go to martial arts 3 days a week instead of four because she needs more of a break than. So I do. I like to pay attention to those things just to see if they can give any kind of an indicator in or insight into how to help them in their strengths.
And my son now he's 13 and he's really, really into sports a lot. And he started with football, and then he did some martial arts, and then he wanted to, what was the next thing? I don't know. It was almost every year something different, or sometimes even, you know, not even the full year. And now he's really getting excited. He says, I want to know as many different sports as possible.
That's cool.
This year he's into tennis and volleyball, and when you watch him with the movements, and he also did some sports acrobatics, he combines, you know, the movement of
yeah.
all those different sports, and I can see the benefit from, you know, bringing this different variety together. It's really beautiful, and
yeah.
It's of course it's also a beautiful skill for life because he can deal with a lot of different sports.
Yes.
And he might not be really, really, you know, top in any of them, but you know, he knows in any of those sports how to improve if he wants to.
Yes. Yes. There's something in the book, I think it's Grit. They talk about how some people think it's good to put a kid into, but at least until they're 12, at least until then, it's best for them just to experiment and try different things. That's what's best for their physical development, for adaptability, for all the things. There's so much benefit to trying and learning more than one thing.
And once he was at this martial art class, I thought, it would be good to do another year and another year, and especially martial art, you know, I mean, you're really getting good if you're practicing very long time. But if I would have, I tried him, you know, to bring him to that course, but he wasn't really into it anymore. So I thought, I mean, I might have, if I, you know, if I pressured him into this, he would have maybe really lost, not losing interest in it, but disliked the sports at one, at some point. And now he's like, oh, what else? And he, right now he's searching into martial arts again, but a different one.
Yeah.
So again, it's like this, and especially yesterday we were playing volleyball in a team, and someone said, watching him with his unique kind of movements, he was like, are you playing football as well? Are you, and then are you playing this as well? And actually right now he doesn't play any of those things, but he integrated the motorical movements, all of them in his body.
That's awesome.
Which is beautiful. Yes. Yes.
That's cool. The desire to learn and experience things. That's cool to see that in action.
Do you have, Sasha, any question from me, or any statement?
No, I mean, I was so curious about, I could ask you a million questions, but I don't know, like, if you talk about yourself a lot on these or not.
Go ahead.
So tell me what prompted your decision to move to homeschooling and unschooling when it's not a common thing where you are.
We were living, when my son was very little, we were living in Vienna, which is the capital of Austria. And for me, it was clear that he would be in any kind of alternative schooling thing, like Montessori, for example, or something. And because my own experiences in regular school was in a way where I just knew I didn't want my son in there. And then when he was four, we moved to the countryside where I grew up originally. And there was this one Montessori school. And I was like, cool, this is the school then. And I've heard good things about it. So when he was five, I think he started in preschool there. And the first few months, he did like it. And then his teacher changed. And there was a new teacher. And the rule in the school was, the kids could choose the project they were working on, and they had to finish the project. And once the project is finished, they could choose the next project out of a pool of projects. And so he was finishing his project and already had chosen what he wanted to do next and was very clear on that. And this new teacher said, no, this project, you can't do it now because you still don't know, you're still not really good at letters and reading and writing, and so you have to get into reading and writing as your next project. And for him, this was such a trust issue created. I mean, he really lost trust in that environment, that he basically from one day to the other didn't want to go there anymore.
Okay.
And his father one morning took him there, and my son said, didn't want to stay, and started crying. And his father, he still left, but came home and was really devastated and said, this was such an awful experience now. I don't think I can ever do this again. And I knew I couldn't have done it in the first place. Already, you know, then there was like, and you know, it was already clear that this was just this one day thing. It was clear that he didn't want to go there anymore. And this was a couple months before he had to enroll into school. It, you know, the duty for school started. So I was like, oh, what are we going to do now? I mean, regular school is not an option for me. This is the only alternative school in the area. So what am I going to do now? And I knew that there was this option of homeschooling, but I've never really looked into it. And then this, yeah, it's 6 years ago. This was the time when in the German-speaking area, the first online summits started. You know, this was the new thing. And all of a sudden, an online summit started on free and self-led education. And I was watching the summit like for an entire long weekend. And then I really got into the idea was what unschooling, meaning without curriculum, really having the child led through her its own interests. This was the time when I first understood the concept of that. And I was like so fascinated. And this was the opening. And then we went that path.
That's amazing. So you did essentially unschooling from the beginning.
He was in kindergarten, so he was there in structured stuff, and you know. But then we did it from the very beginning. Yes.
That's fantastic.
When he was eight, he was interested in going to school. He wanted to know how it is, and his cousin was in school, and you know. Talked a lot about it, and this was the phase when he was missing the social environment. He was missing other kids throughout the week, and only the weekends when he had other kids around and friends around, it was not enough for him, and he couldn't understand why, which is really hard to understand in any way. So he was like, oh, maybe I want to go into school because there are the other kids and stuff. So I asked in this regular school if he could be there for one day. And we made that happen. And it was, I mean, he was there one day. I picked him up in the afternoon and he didn't mention anything and never requested to go there at all. And I was talking to one of the teachers there, and I got some insights what was happening there, and I really could understand, because there was an emotional, social, interactional level he was not used to.
Yeah,
I mean, he was not even introduced when he came into the class. Really, I mean, they just And so, you know, I found it really, really brave, because there were two teachers, because there was one kid with special needs, and this had an extra teacher. And with this teacher, I talked later on. And she told me that the main teacher came into class and he already was in there. And she just started with, you know, the class and not mentioning anything that there's a new kid in here. And he was like getting more and more uncomfortable and, you know, on his seat. And he already had connected to this other teacher. So he stood up during class, went to this other person and said, I don't feel comfortable. I need to talk to someone. I mean, he was 8 years old and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm so proud of you. And he said, I told him afterwards, and he said, why? This is normal. And this is the, you know, for him, it was normal to take care of his needs.
Yeah.
And for me, who experienced cool, I was like, oh my God, you stood up in the midst of class and went to a teacher and said, you need to talk? Oh
yes.
My gosh, how cool is that? So she went out with him and made him more comfortable then. But, you know, for him, it was like, no, this is not the kind of communication he was longing for.
That is so fascinating. That's so interesting. My kids have said sometimes that they want to go, but only because they want to ride the bus.
Yeah.
Apparently that's a thing, is that homeschool kids would like to ride the school bus. Mine haven't mentioned that in, I don't know, probably a year now, but it's sometimes the little things. That is
sure. Sure.
But it's so neat. And then you said that you all do have to, they do have exams that they have to show up for. So they have to, so how do you I guess moderate the balance between, the self-led learning and also PS, you have to have it be ready for this test at this point in the year.
I mean, it was quite simple and easy the first 4 years. I mean, it's basically, reading, writing, and basic math. I mean, this is usually within the realm of interest of a young kid anyway. And if not, it's not that it not be, not such a big deal to make, some kind of interest. But and the last couple of years, what I also discovered is that, having him, I mean, of course he's conditioned. I mean, humans get conditioned, but not this schooling conditioning. And really, my focus was really keeping him the connection with source and his own being and his own intuition and all, these kinds of things. I see him so easily manifest his whatever he needs and wants in his life. So when he was 10, he said, "Next year I want to be in, I want to learn a bit more structured," which we didn't do before really, because and "I want to have a small group." This was important, a small group. And it was like, on one hand, wow, this was really clear, straight on. He was really clear on that. And on the other hand, it was like, oh my God, how can I provide for that? I mean, I know the area here, there is no small group on homeschoolers with structure. And but it happened. It happened. There was a couple of weeks afterwards, we found a group that we're just building up for a small group of homeschoolers. And ever since, this is 2 years now, he's in that group and he loves his tutors there and he, mentors, he calls them. And they have some structure where they do their academic things, but they also, especially now where they're in the teenager years, the older ones, they do a lot of practical work. They do construction and building work, and they do getting into farming and all those kinds of things. And he loves it there, and it's 4 times a
That's
week.
cool.
And it's but meantime, I mean, I even on the weekends sometimes he wants to go, because he's settling there, and he just loves it. And
That's
so
amazing.
yeah.
That's really cool. That's really cool. I like to hear about that and gives potential for new possibilities in the
Yes.
future.
And I mean, this is everything is possible within that field. Everything is possible. And this is the beauty of it. Whereas in school, I don't see all those possibilities. But here,
Very
whatever
much
you
so.
create, you create.
That's
Yeah.
amazing. That's very cool.
Sasha, this was such a nice talk. Thank you so much for your time and for your insights you gave us. And it was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this.
I will put this interview on my feed and also later on YouTube. So yeah, whoever is interested on listening to this on another channel, or if you or anyone is interested in sharing, you can do this from YouTube. Thank you
Beautiful.
so much.
Thank you.
Bye.